Good afternoon. It's Friday afternoon here in Mallorca, and we are now doing a beautiful round table about a very interesting topic together with our friends from Farsounder. But before we start, before we explain what we're doing, I would like to introduce the participants of today, starting with Captain Fraser Gao. Hi, Fraser.
Hi, Otto. Good afternoon. Thanks for having me. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, where are you at the moment?
I'm actually currently on board the Bridge of Stardust. She's a new AMLs, 62 and a half meter, my new command. I left Gene Machine in November last year, where I was working with Farsounder. But no, we're here in the Netherlands and trying to wrap things up and then get to Southeast Asia, hopefully for the winter.
Is your brother still in, is your brother still running Gene Machine?
He is, yes, yeah, yeah.
I met him in St. Thomas in January. And super. Yeah, he's a nice guy, but you're very different, the two of you.
I don't know. You bump into some crew in the docks and they think they recognize you, and then then some say, oh, you're lying to me, you don't have a twin brother, but no, yeah, there's two of us out there.
Yeah, there's two of you out there. Well, thank you, Fraser. Thank you so much for joining us from the Netherlands.
My pleasure.
And we got Mr. Captain Afnish Dahl with us, who's currently, where are you, Afnish?
Oh, well, I'm back in my office in Tarragona. My sailing days are behind me now, but there was a time when we definitely needed some of the equipment we're going to talk about today. And strangely enough, I've just got back from Italy, from a yard over there, where they have fitted the latest in this kind of equipment that we're going to talk about. So I had a quick demo of it. It was in the water, the yacht. So I had a quick demo of it. Interesting. And I think the one that I saw was pretty much latest cutting edge equipment over there.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for joining us as well. We're waiting for Richard. Richard Hodgson will be popping into this session, like hopefully within 10 minutes. Because he's doing sea trials, so he just got back slightly later. But we're also here with Matthew Zimmerman from Farsounder. Hi, Matthew.
Hi, Ono. Thanks for having us today. I'm here at the Farsounder offices in Rhode Island in the United States. We're actually in the middle of putting together a whole online training program since most of our in-person events have been canceled this year. So I'm taking advantage of our fancy new gray backdrop and hopefully not so bad lights for today's roundtable.
Well, so good. Thank you for being here. And finally, but last but not least, Heath. Welcome, Heath.
Thank you, Ono. I'm coming to you from my home in Providence, Rhode Island, home office. As opposed to Matthew, who's the VP of engineering, he's a little more higher level technical type guy. I'm very much on the, I guess, in the weeds of the technical stuff. I'm software development, and I work with some of our R&D projects at Farsounder. So
great, fantastic. So before we go into the Farsounder project, I think that let's share some experiences. And I've got an email here from Stephen Thomas, who is, like, as I said, is for the captain of Fallujah. He gave his opinion, and which I'm going to share later. But I want to hear from Fraser and Afnish a little bit. Like, when you travel a lot, obviously, but sometimes you come to unfamiliar places, or oftentimes poorly charted destinations. Like, Fraser, is that something that happens to you a lot, or have you seen everything by now?
No, it certainly happens and has happened to me a lot, and it continues to happen. I think the quality of some of the ECTIS charts that we're receiving could be better as they get transferred over to the S52 and S63 standard. So we are a full paperless. We operate a fully paperless bridge on fully integrated ECTIS. But we also in the background run with, I often sort of say that they're not Mickey Mouse, but they're more of a consumer product, you know, Max C time zero with, you know, a different chart database to cross-reference against the ECTIS. And certainly what spurred us on to talking to Farsounder in late 2017 was a trip to Svalbard, where we were off the beaten track. A lot of the times we're in bays where receding glaciers had now given us the ability to access these bays that that had no chart data whatsoever. And it's terrifying going in there. Probably shouldn't be going in there, but going in there with following our tenders and feeling our way into where the guests would like to be. And you know, the Far Sounder, that the idea came from that experience. And then we also went down the route of having equipment installed on our tenders to be able to give us you know, more capability of receiving chart data by means of a WASP side scan sonar remotely by not having to put the yacht in direct harm's way. So mm-hmm. we went through both stages of installing the Far Sounder on the mothership and also a WASP on our tenders that could nip ahead, and that way we're covering all bases.
So how did you do it before you had this solution?
Well, we always used a mixture of technology. In the Bahamas, for example, or Caribbean, where the water is quite clear, we often use drones. And we mm-hmm. put drones above us, and you can spot rocks and coral heads and coral bombs. For example, one trip into the Silver Bank to watch humpback whales calving, we you know, could put a drone up in the air for sort of 500 meters above the vessel for, you know, 10, 15 minutes at a time and spot all of the coral heads and navigate our way through there to the anchorage where we were supposed to be. You know, traditionally you put a tender out in front and use yeah. their echo sounder, but obviously with a standard echo sounder, there's a chance they can miss something. So, you know, the more technology, the better, I think. You can yeah. incorporate it all together.
Great. Afnish, what's your opinion on this? How did you do it? I don't want to say that you were, that you're an old captain, but you've been around for a long time. So if you unmute yourselves and share your opinion, that would be amazing.
Well, yeah, I haven't done, you know, that much sailing in the Caribbean when we were in, let's say, not so well charted waters, but we did a lot in the Maldives, where the coral heads is still uncharted quite a bit, and a lot of boats have had accidents there. Plus in the Laccadives on the Indian side, and in the Andamans inside the atoll, obviously we never navigated at sunrise and dusk and dawn, because that's a time when you really can't see the color differences too well. But that was one of the things, and send the tender up ahead. The tender normally has at least an echo sounder if you're navigating in those waters, so send it up ahead and follow him in slowly. I remember one particularly scary one in the Andamans, where we were told, local knowledge, that there was a little bay near Havelock, little bay going up on the mainland, and then it opened up into a little channel going up, and then it opened up into this into this bay. But that was really scary. Not much space on either side, maybe a meter and a half under the keel. You know, you're feeling your way forward with both your tenders up ahead, and then it opened up into this beautiful bay. I mean, fantastic experience, because you could see the alligators on the shore. You could hear the monkeys at night. It was like a mangrove surrounding on all four sides. Fantastic experience, but to get there was scary, to say the least. Something like this, what Far Sounder has got going, and the modern technologies, I think if you're going into waters like this, which is getting more popular at this point, it would have been a fantastic asset.
Yeah. Well, I've also have you ever had to say no to an owner, to a guest, like, I can't go there because there's no way that I know if I can get in?
Well, I mean, you know my nature, right? So if I said no, it wasn't possible. I mean, I would try everything possible, but definitely, yeah. Most of the time when I was in those waters, it was on a 50 meter. We were doing this kind of stuff on a 50 meter, which is much easier than if you're doing it on a 65 or 100 meter. On the 100 meter, we never really tried anything too scary. We played it much safer, but yes, on the 50 meter, we went on the edge quite a bit. But I had a good crew. That was one thing. We had boat tenders out. We had local knowledge most of the time. So kind of trusted it, went down slowly, never in bad weather. And yes, to answer the question, yes, I've said no. But it was really, you know, at times when it was difficult to say no, but yes, when you have to say it, you have to say it.
What about you, Fraser? Do you ever say no? I can't go there. Don't trust it. Don't know it.
Before we had the Wasp and the Far Sounder, yes, absolutely. Yeah. You know, the Bahamas, where it's a sandy bottom, it's all about taking calculated risks. And you know, if there's a chance where you might just put the bow into the sand and say, okay, well, that's as far as we're going, and we're going to back out and drop the anchor. You know, whereas if it's a rocky shoreline, then chances are you'll take less risks because the impact is going to be that much more severe, or the damage potentially caused. You know, cruising around Svalbard, for example, is probably the most extreme cruising I've done with our guests on G Machine. And at times we're in the bridge with the owner, and we both said, yeah, that doesn't feel good. And I think what I've learned is you just go with your gut instinct more than often. And if it doesn't feel right, then you know, back out and try somewhere else. So have I had to say no? Probably not too many times, because it's just sort of the owner never really pushed me. He said, mm-hmm. You know, can we go in there? Well, we can try. Okay, it's starting to get a bit skinny and a little bit shallow. So let's just stop here and let's not push our luck.
Yeah, well, so thank you for sharing. Isn't Stephen has relayed to me, he says, like, that the hydrographer of the Saudi Port Authority some years ago refused to issue their charge as they were so inaccurate. Basically, he said, like, I'm not even giving them to you because I don't trust my own charts. I mean, this is, Matthew, is that a story that you've heard before?
Yeah, you know, we've heard similar things more than once. Right now, we're talking about users in the yacht market, but we work with customers in various marine markets. And one market that's really starting to grow for us is the government survey market. So surveyors, by definition, are going places that they don't know what's there. They may have an idea because of the trends or what it was 50 years ago, the last time they went, but by definition, they don't know what's there. So there's now a whole bunch of survey vessels around the world using our equipment to make sure it's safe for them to get into the areas to do the official surveys. One of the things that I'm constantly amazed with is the U.S. has some of the best charts in the world for U.S. territorial waters. And our charts are horribly lacking in a lot of places. So, you know, when we hear about people going to the Maldives, going up into Greenland, going into these hard to reach places, which are super awesome destinations, like, that's amazing to me that people are able to do that. So, you know, it's not only determination and technology, but, you know, having the skills and the confidence to do that, I think is pretty impressive. One of the things I heard Captain Fraser mention was using a bunch of different tools. And I think that is a great way to look at the problem. So he's talking about risk management. What can you do to reduce the risks and increase your probability of success? Well, there's not going to be a magic silver bullet, but there can be great tools in your toolbox. And looking at a variety of these tools and having them work together, I think is really a key strategy. And one of the things that we've really been trying hard to do at Far Sounder is make our technology and our products easy to use and easy to integrate with these other tools. Because when you add three more tools on the ship, you're not adding three more specialized personnel to run them. You know, you have the bridge crew adding more tasks. So we need to make sure that we do it easily and safely and quick to understand, easy to interpret, so you can look at all these tools together.
Do you think, like, this is something that, like, when I was speaking to a few other captains, there's a bit of, like, and I would like to hear your opinion, Heath and Matthew, but also Fraser and Afnish, obviously. Say, some people, they thrive by the electronics. They say, the electronics is my lifesaver. But some others say they help, but they cannot substitute for training and planning. So, Afnish, Fraser, what do you think on, what's your opinion on this?
You want to go first, Fraser?
Sure. I think when we're talking about this particular topic, you have to have a love for the electronics and advancing the technology. Obviously, traditional techniques, you know, old school lead lining, you know, it did its task. However, we're moving into an era of forward facing sonar, 4G connected tenders, transmitting bathymetric data back to the bridge in real time. I don't think you can compete with that with traditional techniques. You know, I was reading about Paul Allen's Vulcan company doing the satellite. They're trying to chart all the shallow waters and coral reefs using satellite imagery. So I think, again, going back to where Matthew was saying, if we pull this all together, then you've got all the toolkit to have a successful voyage and mission. You know, for example, on Gene Machine, the Far Sounder was awesome when we were steaming and in areas where our confidence in the chart and in the chart wasn't great. Whereas once you start getting into shallower water and slowing down, then we tend to go over towards the tender. Obviously, still having both systems running, but you put them all together, and I don't think any old school techniques really can give you the same amount of data that you're getting from a drone, from the Far Sounder, from a WASP system, and also from plain simple Google Earth when you're planning your trips into areas.
Good. Avnish, what's your opinion?
I would like to add one thing to that there's also a great comfort factor on just having your bosun right on the front, ready to drop the anchor as soon as we feel something goes wrong. That's the oldest way of feeling comfortable. And the more comfortable one gets or is on the bridge, really you feel more at ease using all the various equipment at your hand. And I think that, you know, keeping yourself, keeping the boat and the crew and the owners and guests safe also requires that comfort level from the person driving the boat. So he needs to have, or I always felt that I needed to have a personal feel of what was going on outside, along with the electronic data that was being passed to us continuously.
Good. Heath, you want to add something to what you just heard from your background and knowledge?
Sure. So I think I totally agree that it's really important to use all these different incoming data streams. But I think, and it's probably hard to compete with the traditional techniques. But I think it's also important to emphasize that the crew have comprehensive training on how to interpret all the data that they're seeing from manufacturers or representatives. So one thing that we've been working to do is move all of our training online so that we can offer training sort of on the spot to anyone who needs it. And we've also been offering free end user training. So we have one of our engineers on the bridge or remoting into the bridge, presenting to the bridge crew and showing them how to interpret what they're seeing on the system. Yes, all this incoming data, this new technology is super useful, but also it's really important, probably a little bit obvious, to know exactly how to use it. I've been bringing that up, even though it seems like an obvious point, but we have seen cases where we've had crews that don't know how to use the system that's installed. There's different reasons that can happen, but it is a point that we want to hit. So.
Thank you so much.
Can I add something?
Yeah, go for it, Matthew.
You know, it's an interesting point that Heath makes, knowing how to use the equipment. But I think that also goes back to being confident in the fundamentals of navigation. So, you know, everyone's using a GPS, but what happens when the GPS isn't working? Like, you still want to be able to revert back to less sophisticated, more traditional means. And I think that applies everywhere. And with more training, not only from a particular piece of technology, but all the different systems and techniques that have been employed for hundreds of years, allows you to better understand when you do have a problem. So You know, everyone's heard about the story of the idiot driver who just follows their GPS in the car and they drive off the bridge. Well, because the GPS told me to. Well, they didn't have an alarm saying the GPS isn't working. They just followed a non-working thing. So having a background in not only the specific product and the specific tool you're using, but understanding the other tools and the other techniques helps you internally make decisions and recognize when something's working well or not working well. So, you know, for example, you're using a radar, and because of weather, you might not see something that you would expect to see on the radar under good conditions. Well, does that mean there's nothing there? Well, probably, maybe, but maybe not. But you need to be able to recognize, okay, we're in a condition where the radar system is not going to be working out to 100% maximum specifications. We need to downgrade our reliability on that one sensor. If you're operating in fog, you know, you can't use your eyes as much as you could during clear conditions. And maybe you want to rely on some sort of thermal imaging better. So it's recognizing how all the tools work together, and certainly training is one key component in that.
Yeah. It's all about de-risking, isn't it, Matthew, in the end?
Yeah. I mean, I like to think of the analogy of scuba diving. I do a lot of scuba diving, and I do some light technical diving with decompression and mixed gases. And when I see new divers, they immediately go to the fancy dive computer that tells them exactly what to do. I did hundreds of dives manually with a depth gauge and a timer and paper because, well, at the time I couldn't afford the computer, but it also ingrained in me the fundamental concepts of how long I can be at a certain depth and why and what happens. And so if you have a computer that breaks for some reason, you now know how to revert to the manual system of timers and charts and tables to return from that dive safely. And you know, that's true for any sort of high-risk activity. It's a chosen mitigated risk rather than a complete avoidance.
Fantastic. Anybody want to add something to that, to what Matthew just said, Fraser, Efnish? And if not, not. He's been very elaborate. Thank you so much for that, Matthew. I've had some feedback as well. So listen, especially the captains who've been around for a bit, I'd say, like, we learned the skills to be a professional navigator, and that helps us today, even with the new technology, to understand better what I'm seeing, what I'm reading, because obviously it's like, if taking your example, if you step to a car as a new driver, well, yeah, you've got your license, but it doesn't mean you really know what you're doing. It's a learning by experience as well. The only thing with a vessel is it can sink. So that's not the best of solutions. One of the learning points we wanted to touch base on is the workflow. So when in situations with potential navigational hazards or inadequate chart data arise, what do you do? Matthew, you want to kick that one off and then ask Fraser and Afnish to respond to that?
Sure. And I think this is a great question. I'm excited to hear other people's answers. One of the things that we try to do a lot with my team is recognize that we are not ship captains, we're not vessel operators, we're engineers. So we always try hard to listen and return some sort of product that meets needs that we've heard, rather than trying to guess and force them into what we imagine is the right way to do things. And one thing that we've really found effective with our customers is a chart overlay display that we have, where we make a 3D sonar and we have a 3D picture in our software. It looks really sexy. At trade shows, people stop and they're like, wow, awesome, cool 3D image. Like, that's really neat as an engineer, but for the vessel operator, they want to have, we've seen, a quick and easy way to see where is it safe and where is it not safe. And they're nominally operating by charts. And when the sonar is overlaid on the chart and they see a sonar image that correlates with what the chart data says, it gives them a high confidence in the chart information for that area. With the chart overlay, you can quickly see objects and targets that are not marked on the chart or not positioned in the same place on the chart very easily. And then that gives the navigator a signal that, hey, the sonar showing this picture, the chart showing that picture, they don't quite line up. So let's downgrade our reliability in the charts. Maybe that means reducing vessel speed a little bit so they have more time to make decisions. Maybe that means posting crew on the bow. Maybe it means deploying the drone, deploying the tender, paying attention more to the radar and the sonar, whatever it might mean for that condition. Having the multiple data types, this data fusion between the sonar and the chart, and likewise with the radar and the chart, I think is a great tool for helping to understand that.
Yeah. I mean, Fraser's called away for a second. I see him like walking off the bridge or out of the saloon. Avnish, would you like to care to respond to what Matthew just said?
Yeah, so, I mean, I must say, I wish I would have done more of the exploration passages and voyages, but even with all the miles I put in, I don't think I did like my total passages in areas that have not been well documented is not more than 0.01% of my total sailing career. You know, I mean, really at the end, even if you're going in, and as Yachty is, unlike in my previous part of my life in commercial shipping, as a Yachty, we get used to taking boats in very close inshore. You know, at the end, we want to take the boat right up to where the owners can wave out to the beach or whatever. But mostly, it's all been areas which the boats have been doing it 100 times for the last 10 years. So you're not really expecting anything to come up. You have a fair degree of confidence that you can get close and drop anchor, and the wind's going to blow in the same direction for that afternoon, let's say. So I would have loved to be in more places like, you know, where really the navigation is more stressful, and it doesn't really happen. I think there are very few of us in the industry that have been lucky enough to go to these kind of places which are completely out of the way. And obviously, when I was at sea or in yachting, even as close back as, let's say, 3-4 years ago, we didn't have access to that much equipment as there is today. I mean, the advances have been huge in the last couple of years. So I think, you know, Fraser probably would probably enjoy more of that than I would have done, for sure. So whenever we felt that we were getting into a place where things would get a little sticky, we went back to basics, really. You know, it was, we don't navigate at night. We, in the atolls, you know, if you have to navigate or move from one atoll to another, get out of the passage and do it in the open sea and then wait before you go into the next atoll. I mean, that was the way we did it. Never do, you know, anytime when your visibility will get impaired, we don't do it. Don't do it when the sea is, you know, when there are ripples so that you can't really make out the color difference. It was really back to basics then. Put the tender down, make sure the tender goes ahead. It wasn't so bad as actually putting a lead line down like 200 years ago. But for sure, we sent, you know, the tender out ahead, tender to the sides. And when you finish dropping anchor in your turning circle, make sure the tender goes out and checks there's nothing there. So it was a lot more back to basics from my perception or my point of what sailing I did.
Yeah. And if that equipment would have been available, Afnish, do you think you would have gone to other places?
Yeah, well, I mean, going to other places is not is really the, you know, if you have the luck to be on a boat which is going, you get there. But like I was saying when we started the session, I've just come back from Italy from a visit to a shipyard, and they very kindly took me around one of their new builds, and the boat was in the water. She's been launched, and they had fantastic sonar equipment. Forward-looking and, well, forward and 360 and stern and 360. So it was amazing. Even just in the dock, you know, they put it on and it was phenomenal. You know, I mean, like something like that can save your life for sure.
Yeah. Before we'll move on. I mean, obviously, I'm very happy that we have Fast Sounder here and But like for the people that are listening, Matthew, and do not really know what you guys do, I could have done this in the beginning, but that would be too obvious. So can you just quickly explain where FireSounder comes from? Because you obviously are the founder of FireSounder, and then Fraser, you're like, Jimmy, so you were a client, so maybe let's take this commercial moment. So guys, commercial break, we're selling FireSounder, and we'll get back to topic afterwards. Go for it, sure. Matthew.
Thank you. So I'm one of the founders at FireSounder, and I formed the company in April 2001 with the mission of how do we make navigating safer. We're based in Rhode Island in the United States, and shortly before forming FireSounder, we had an oil spill not too far from here. In the world of oil spills, it was small, but in the world of our local environment, it was pretty big. And it was a case of an oil barge, it hit a rock, ripped a hole in the barge, spilled a bunch of oil. We also have the North Atlantic right whales that live near here. And they are called right whales because they were the right whales to hunt. They're slow, they're stupid, they sit right at the surface, they don't run away. Nowadays, they basically don't die until a ship hits them. And so we figured, hey, there must be a way to avoid hitting rocks and avoid hitting whales. When I was in the ocean engineering program at the University of Rhode Island, we talked to the research vessel captain and said, hey, Fred, where's your thing that shows us where the rocks and whales are? And he said, we don't have one of those. I said, why not? You should have one. That'd be great. He said, they don't make such a thing. And naive as we were, we said, oh, well, we could do that. Can't be that hard. It turned out it was a lot harder than we thought, and it took a lot longer than we thought, and it cost a lot more money than we thought. But here we are, 20 years later, basically delivering that product that a lot of the big companies said was physically impossible. It's too big. It's too expensive. You can't make it work. Okay, well, come out on the boat. We'll show you it working. And now we have customers all around the world using our products. We have three products, one which goes out 350 meters range, one which goes 500 meters range, and one which goes 1,000 meters range. And those are installed on yachts, expedition cruise ships, survey vessels, research vessels, light military and Coast Guard vessels. So a whole wide variety of use cases and applications. And we envision that one day there will be a price and performance point for every class of vessel. And basically, any ship or boat that you see using a radar today, one day we think there's going to be a undersea and underwater sensor for forward-looking navigation suitable for them as well.
Thank you, Matthew. That was a great way to introduce this. Thank you. Fraser, and as you are a, well, happy customer, if I may say so, are they really that good?
I mean, for me, I certainly enjoyed using the FireSounder product. We had an F500, so we were seeing 500 meters in front. I wish we'd gone for the 1,000 meter in front, because obviously, you know, the sooner you can see something and the further ahead, the better. We had a few moments, and I think that was particularly during the initial phase of installation with lack of crew knowledge, training, and also fine-tuning of the system where it would actually really scare you. It would all of a sudden, you'd see something on the screen and the alarm would start going and you'd think, uh-oh, when am I about to hit something? And there was nothing there. And that was changing water temperature, water columns, all sorts of different stuff that we were dealing with that Matt and his team helped us overcome. I think when it comes to yachts, particularly shallow water navigation, the range decreases, which makes it probably not the most effective tool in shallow water navigation, but I don't think any of them are. I think even the Wasp suffers there when you just don't have the depth under the keel to get the Matt, help me out here. What's that called? The swath?
The water depth performance. So yeah. What you're talking about is the sonar can map the bottom of the seafloor ahead of the vessel a multiple of the times of depth of water below the sonar. So our system is an 8 water depth sonar, and that means we can see underwater in a 3D picture 8 times the depth ahead of the vessel. Beyond that, we can still show you where obstacles and targets are. We just can't tell you how deep they are. We can tell you the range, the bearing, and how loud a reflector that is. And that's really a limitation of physics. So it's really something that you can't get around, but you can try to work with as best as possible.
But I think going back to it, Ono, it really comes down to confidence. And yeah. Once you start to see that the chart's matching up with the picture that the far sounder is painting, then you start to get an overall confidence and you feel a lot better about everything. So no, it's absolutely a great tool to have. And I think as we're seeing this sort of, I think it's a fad in the yachting industry that we're starting to talk more about explorer yachts, because really I think most yachts that are built, that are around the 500 GT and above are capable of exploring the world. We don't have to have a specific class for them. They're a little bit more rugged but we took G Machine to the far ends of the earth, and we're going to head to Antarctica as well. And people were criticizing, saying, well, you can't take classic yachts to these environments. And I disagree strongly, especially when you equip them with the right tools like Far Sounder, Wasp, for underwater imaging anyways, above other things. But no, it's a wonderful tool, and I certainly miss having it at the moment.
This is a good moment for me to introduce Richard. Hi, Richard. Thank you for joining us. There's an unmute button on your screen. If you press that, we can hear you. But just below, there's a little, like, next to your video, there's like a microphone button.
Hi, everyone.
Hi, Richard. Thank you for joining us. How was your day at sea?
Super late. Pulled into Mykonos, actually, on the last little trip for the owners on Choppy Choppy.
Great. Well, yeah. Thank you so much for being with us. We already had a lot chat, long chat. Avnish and Fraser have been telling heroic stories how they survived the depths and the coral reefs, and with tenders all around them. And the big story, sorry, Fraser, Avnish, I'm teasing you a little bit, but like, and we're just going into I just gave Matthew the moment to pitch Far Sounder in our commercial break, because I really want this to be like a broad topic talking about all the things. Are you a Far Sounder user, Richard?
I have fitted Far Sounder onto 4 yachts now. I've been using it since 2008, okay. From the initial stages, and we've gone through every phase and every upgrade and every update. I'm an avid supporter. I mean, I heard Fraser there talking about exploration. I mean, even in port, or the place I've just been to now in Rhenia, a small island, the charts there basically are zero. You always nudge in there, look around before you tie stone through the rocks, and, 4 meters of water, 4.5 meters of water with a 3.5 meter, 4 meter draft. So it's a very valuable tool. In the Mediterranean and the Caribbean, as well as obviously looking ahead of you when you're on the longer passages. Great. I'm an avid supporter of it. Yeah, 4 of them to answer you.
4 of them. Do you have the 1,000 or the 500?
What do we have on there now, Matt? On this, it depends. If you go into Mariah, I think it's.
I think you started with our legacy product, the FS3, yeah. Which only went 300 meters. And I believe. The last couple of your ships are Argos 500, so the 500 meter range systems.
Yeah. Well, Fraser just told us we should have gone for the 1,000, right, Fraser?
That's my opinion. I would have wished to have had more distance ahead of me, especially when cruising at speed.
Yeah. I do want to touch base on something you said earlier, Fraser, and Richard, I highly appreciate your opinion on this as well. You say in shallow waters, it works, but like the same as the Wasp, but it's more complicated, because when I was in Abaco 2 years ago, just before the hurricane hit, those are those waters where I spoke to a lot of captains that we wish to move up north to the Bahamas, but we just don't dare, because around Exumas, we know on and about what we can expect. When we got up there with all the shallow waters, it becomes more complicated. So how do you solve that then? Richard, Fraser, Matthew, anybody who wants to say something on this?
Well, my experience using the under in the Bahamas, the shallow waters, is you just have to slow down. Okay. You can't see as far ahead, so you just go slower. And again, we're talking using multiple tools, drones, tenders, and also the WASP system. So that's just one of the disadvantages of going into shallow water. But yeah, certainly the deeper the water, the nicer the image and the clearer it becomes. But.
Great.
I actually have a couple of pictures that might help explain it for you, Ono, if I could present that for just a moment. It's not a whole presentation, just a couple of quick.
You are cultivating this moment, I think, but please feel very welcome to share your screen and show us some pictures.
Okay, so I think that I can present that just like this.
Yeah. Make sure you, when you present them, to talk a bit about them, because that's for the people that listen to the podcast instead of watching the video, that they know what we're looking at.
Of course. So do you guys see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, so if you have a basic echo sounder, your energy goes straight down and almost all of that energy reflects back up to you. However, you can't just stick an echo sounder facing forward because it won't tell you everything that you need to see. And the reason for that's pretty straightforward, and that's also where this limit of bottom mapping range, the function of depth below the sonar, comes into play. As you push that energy forward, at a steep angle, most of that energy comes back to you, but some of that energy reflects forward. And at a more shallow angle, of course, less energy comes back and more reflects forward, until eventually, at some angle, the seafloor is reflecting all of that sonar energy, but it's reflecting forward. So the seafloor is reflecting, just it's not coming back to you. It's kind of like shining a flashlight on a mirror. If you're kind of lined up with the mirror, the flashlight's going to shine back on you. But once you get wide enough away on an angle, that mirror is going to reflect the light forward. And so it turns out with our product, this ratio is about 8:1. So 8 times the depth below the sonar is where the seafloor pretty much reflects all your energy forward. Beyond that, if there's a rock, though, you now have an edge that's going to reflect back to you. So you can see in-water targets beyond your bottom mapping range. And this picture is a picture of the seafloor out ahead of the vessel. There's a couple of bridge pilings. We can see them on the chart. And there's some bridge pilings here. Those are showing up in the 3D view over there. Everything within that bottom mapping range shows up in 3D. But everything beyond that, we only really know the range, the bearing, and the reflectivity level. And the reason for that is once you get beyond that bottom mapping range where the energy is reflecting forward, it's now bouncing off the seafloor, bouncing off the sea surface, maybe even more than one time. But still, if you get a target at long range that has now an edge to reflect back to you, you're going to get some reflections back. So if you think about a long range example, this is with an Argos 1000, we can see the seafloor mapped in 3D. That's what we see as that blue surface ahead of the vessel. But at long range, we're seeing the rocks along the shoreline as in water targets. In this case, it's correlating really well with the chart. So you have pretty good confidence in the chart. I looked at a very similar picture with one of our customers off the coast of Antarctica. They had what they believed were pretty good charts, and they turned the sonar on, and they saw the exact same shape as the shoreline in the sonar as was shown in the charts. Unfortunately, the sonar showed it 80 meters closer to them than what the chart showed. And so that was a great example of the charts are nominally right, but positioned in the wrong place. And so they were like, holy cow, yeah, we thought we were really comfortable here. We're just barely comfortable here. So having that chart overlay to correlate, even with targets beyond your bottom mapping range, like this case here, can really offer a lot of added value and helping the navigator really understand how good their charts are and whether they can rely on them. Or they need to revert back to some of those other techniques with the drones, with the tenders, and so forth.
Sorry, Matt, just to intervene on that. Something to consider when you are looking at these charts is usually the GPS antenna is 50 or 60 meters aft of the sonar, which is on the front, and if that hasn't been compensated for, then you're very likely to feel nearer to the shore with your sonar as you are with your GPS. So comparing charts is quite a difficult thing.
Yeah, and in our software, we do have settings for the location of the GPS antenna and the sonar sensor and the vessel size. But as you've pointed out, garbage in is garbage out. If you're putting in the wrong values, you're not going to get the right answer back. So it's really important that when we work with the our customers, that we're able to get correct values from them or from the shipyard. And sometimes it's not so well known, especially in larger ships with huge integrated bridge systems. They often use a virtual GPS antenna location so that regardless of which GPS antenna is being used, their outputs are positioned to the same place on the vessel. But not all the crew know that. And so it comes down to really an education and training question. And hopefully that allows with a well-educated, well-trained crew to get the correct information into the systems that are using those ancillary data types.
Good. Thank you for that, Matthew. I want to move to the last topic, and I think I need to look at Heath, because he's going to, I don't even know how to pronounce this, crowdsource bathymetry. And this is like out of my comfort zone. And you were going to explain what it is.
So what is it is, as we were talking about, there's a lot of holes in the charts or old chart data that's making its way into charts. And that's because the hydrographic offices are tasked with going out and performing all the surveys to update the charts. They don't physically have the manpower to do this, to update all of the coastal waters. I think it's something like, the IHO has a document, C55. It's something like 55% of the water, the coastal water, less than 200 meters, is not adequately charted according to their standards globally. So it's a huge number, and that's pretty shallow, relatively shallow water. And so how do you chart that? And people started to brainstorm about that and think about it. And there's a lot of vessels out there from all different types of classes that are navigating around collecting data with echo sounders. And the idea is crowdsource it. So take that data that they're collecting anyway for their own navigation, get it to some central location, and then anyone can use it, be it a hydrographic office or an industry partner, anyone. And that benefits, I guess, everyone. And so the International Hydrographic Organization, the IHO, set out to do this. They established a working group of researchers, scientists, and industry representatives to put together guidance on how to collect this, like basically how to collect this data, what it should look like, what kind of metadata do you need, all of these requirements. They put together guidance for this. And they're also working with NOAA to manage a database to contain all of this data. And so they've been doing this for years. I'm not sure the start date, but Far Center got involved after they had developed the original guidelines. We got involved to say, hey, we have a forward-looking sounder. We have customers that are going to, like you guys know, very interesting areas that are not well charted. How can we start contributing and using that data as well? So we've been looking at how to do that. We started a pilot program where our customers can collect data and forward it to the NOAA database. So I got a little off track there, but yeah, so that's what crowdsourced bathymetry is. It's basically mariners contributing what they've collected with their echo sounders to some database that's accessible to all, and hydrographic offices or any entity can pull from that and use it to do what they want with it. And some hydrographic offices are already using it to update charts. It depends on each individual hydrographic office. So
Good. Richard, as you have, like, do you participate in this program? Do you, or is it because if you're a FileStandard client, you automatically share the data to your Sonar, or how does it work?
Unfortunately, no. I want to say, yeah, we do it. No, we don't participate in, I think one of our boats does, actually. I think maybe Nimty does. But we haven't actually opted into it. I think it's probably because our systems are on the first two were is the older system. But it's something we'll be talking about on the next one because we're just speccing another 80 meter and we're also trying to slide it onto Rev at the moment.
Right. So how did you feel positive about this initiative?
Yeah, anything. Anything that we can give back. I mean, we're cruising around these areas anyway. If it's going to give somebody an insight into something, it's much more difficult, obviously, in areas like the Bahamas where the sands are shifting regularly, and that's what makes it difficult. But, you know, places like I've been today, as I said, the chart is blank, but you're bouncing signals off all sorts of solid objects as you approach it. So why not? We should be sharing every bit of information we can. You know, definitely, I agree to it. I don't think we've got the capability on two of the yachts at the moment, but Matthew will tell you that. I can't actually remember if we do on this one or not.
Well, before we go to Matthew, let's hear what Fraser has to say on this. Fraser, is this something that you support or would support?
Oh, absolutely. We've looked into that on several occasions prior to having the FileStandard. There's little black boxes you can install on board and send data back. And my personal belief is the more depth information, the more data points we can send back to either the NOAA crowdsource one or any of the UKHO, will make the ocean safer. And if anything, will prevent accidents for saving lives or preventing environmental catastrophes from tankers or even yachts sinking and running aground or damaging, you know, sensitive ecosystems. That's what we need to be doing. So on G Machine, we've got a hard drive. I'm not sure if Matthew's received one back from them full of data yet or not. But it's you know, there's nothing to it. You plug it in, and then when it fills up, you send it back to FileStandard, and they do all the legwork. So it makes sense. And I think if everyone could be doing that or recording their depths wherever we're going, as Richard said, it's not just off the beaten track. It's everywhere. So no, it's great. I'd absolutely participate.
Avnish, from your long experience, I know you're not on vessels anymore, but would that be something that you would have like participated in?
Yes, for sure. Just as, you know, one tries, well, the yachting industry is such that even if you are having to keep professional discretion, I think we all try to participate as much as we can in various ways in the industry by passing on information. The industry is, I mean, it's a new industry. 30, 40 years is all we're really talking about. So every piece of information that we are able to pass to each other, I think, is of great value. And a lot of people in the industry actually have that philosophy where we pass that information on in various ways, sometimes in a more organized manner, and sometimes just by the conversations we have when we meet up with each other, passing on information about different places, the way we, the new technologies, how we've handled situations. It's a very particular industry. Yachties hang out together. So you end up talking about what you're doing, passing on the information, and you know, trying to gather as much knowledge as you can by getting it from other people in the industry.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think we've covered all the topics. I would like to give Matthew the opportunity to have the final say today as our host, and then I'll do a little thank you round and ask us anything has something. Anybody has anything to add?
Thank you, Ono. I appreciate you arranging this roundtable. You know, it's great to see everyone's faces here virtually. I know for me, it's this time of year is I really enjoy because I'm normally traveling, visiting customers, going to trade shows. And for me, some of the most valuable parts of all that travel is really getting feedback, listening to our current customers, listening to potential customers, hearing about their problems, hearing about the situations they're trying to make better. And that's something that is hard to replicate in today's you know, stay-at-home world. So thank you for putting this together. I look forward to, you know, watching and hearing more of yours with other technologies and other topics as well. So thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Matthew. And I mean, to everybody listening, if you got something that you want to share about this, if you got a comment, if you got a suggestion, just like make sure you put in the comments or made it to us. We'll make sure it reaches FastSounder, because I believe they'll embrace everything that will help them improve. And it's like Mike, you said earlier, it's about saving the whales, right? That's what it all started.
And you know, your comment about us listening to feedback and making the system better, I think Richard can probably attest to this. You've probably seen pretty dramatically, you know, the performance from the first system you have to the newest system. We are always releasing software updates. We typically do 3 or 4 updates a year. We try to get them to our customers. One issue we actually have is we don't have our customer contacts because we're selling through a dealer network. So we would love to give all of our customers the latest software to get them the latest capabilities so that they can get more and more out of the system that they have on board.
So this is a shout out, I believe. So basically, if you have a FastSounder system and you haven't done any updates in the recent months or years, there is something new you can get. So just make sure you get in touch. Fraser, thank you so much for joining us. Fraser, any last words from you?
Thank you very much. Nice to see you all, and pleasant to chat, and nice to see you, Matthew, especially. Fingers crossed. I'm pushing for something here, but I we need to get out of the build phase, and then also, we're looking at cruising Southeast Asia, and I think that's a particular area for me where I would really like to have your system on board. So, hopefully, drop me an email.
Great.
I'll message you after. But thanks very much, everyone.
Yeah. Richard, thank you so much for joining. I'm really happy, even though you were at sea, that you took the time to join us today.
No, total pleasure. I'm an advocate of the system. As I say, we've gone from legacy products. We're still putting them onto boats. There's total value in it. Anyone who's thinking about it should just have it there as an additional tool. Anything that helps, really. So I'm totally happy. You've always got my details because I get Christmas cards, I think, even, which is very nice of you. Must be the legacy client thing, Matt.
It's four vessels, huh? Four vessels, Richard. Four Fraser.
We've got lots of plans. We never stop building things. So there's lots of drawings on the table at the moment. It's just these things take a long time, as usual.
Well, thank you very much, Richard. Thank you for having me. Avnish, thank you for being a regular on our show. By the way, Avnish, do you still do your Wednesday morning radio show on Superyacht Radio?
Yes, I do. But Dave and Amov have shifted back to Ireland, so I'm giving them a monthly break. But we're back again next month. You know, I don't know if anyone listens to the songs, but I'm not changing my playlist for anybody. It's still remaining the blues, and it will still always end with the only girl who can really sing the blues now. So that's for sure.
And who's that?
Joss Stone, always.
It's always Joss Stone. It's like I listen to the show. It's really enjoyable. Your daughter hates your playlist, right?
She hates it, but she's always on the show. And now she's actually working with me as an intern. She starts on the 1st. My wife is very worried. My wife's stuck in India because she can't get out, and we are in Spain. My daughter studies in Switzerland, so she's come down here, and my wife is sure that we're going to kill each other, burn the house down or something like that. Something really bad is going to happen. But thanks a lot for having me, and Matthew and Heath, really thanks a lot. It's always nice at least to talk to people. Normally we would be, all of us would be at Monaco at this time. But this year, it's all very strange. Fraser, if you need anything in the Far East, or I'm in Tarragona now, but that's my home area. So if you need anything, take my contacts from Ono, and please get in touch.
And thank you.
We've met along the line. I'm quite sure of it, but I'm sure we'll catch up again once all this is over.
Fantastic. Well, these are sweet words. Heath, thank you so much for joining us as well and sharing your knowledge. And this leads me to thanking everybody. And also, like, we would have been a bit bigger group. I would like to thank Stephen in particular, who sent me a big email with all his remarks. I tried to put them in here during the conversation. The two or three other captains that I spoke to prior to this, because I had to prepare because I was talking to a high-end audience. And I hope I did well enough for you guys. I hope I bluffed my way through this one again. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful Friday and hope to speak to you soon. And I am keep my fingers crossed that Antigua is happening because I just booked my flights.
Okay, I'm not thinking that far ahead because I'm playing golf on Monday at the Messi Foundation. So,
are you invited?
Yes,
I'm not. Well, thank you again. Thank you, Matthew. Thank you, Fraser. Thank you, Heath. Thank you, Avnis. And thank you, Richard.
Thank you.
Have a wonderful day. Bye-bye, everybody. Just close the browser and we're gone.
Thanks, guys. Have a nice weekend. Bye-bye.
Have a nice weekend. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.